In this video series, I'll be giving some advice on how to make the best song you can.
The power is back.
I'm Taylor Brown, a local musician and producer. I also studied music in college for 4 years. And myself, along with Anthony Casuccio, a real professional recording and mastering engineer, and Shane Depree, a professional DJ and music producer, as well as a professional hip-hop dancer. And the three of us, we're going to make this guide, give you some tips on how to produce the best song that you can. This episode of the series will be about composing a song. So this is the planning and writing process of the song that you're going to make. When you listen to pop music, it's interesting because it's never just one particular genre. Pop music always lives up to its name because it's kind of everything that's popular all melded into one. So you'll hear a little bit of rock, you'll hear a little bit of hip hop, you'll hear a little bit of jazz, a little bit of folk, a little bit of country. You'll hear it all. So we're going to talk about some of the different styles and trends that you hear now. Right now, it's no secret that the dominant force is definitely hip-hop music and the rhythms, the vocal technique of rapping, the instrumentation using the 808 kicks, 808 drum sound. You hear all of that in pop music today. Not even pop permeates into classical music and jazz and things like that. Think about how many movie soundtracks you hear that are very trap inspired. Some of the changes that you started to hear in music today too, just with hip hop culture as it's permeated music, you've started to hear the vocals change. Rapping is important to remember that it's a vocal technique. I think people have always heard too, rap is the music, hip hop is the culture. It's very true. Rapping is its own vocal style, just like we've heard other people bring their own innovations to music and they haven't gone anywhere, like crooning, when we started having people stand in front of a microphone to record music, electric guitars, synthesizers. All those things are very old, and at the time, people might have thought of it as a fad. However, it never went away. People are still using those things today. Something that's quite different now too, with hip hop in particular, is starting to kind of merge back into R&B, which is interesting because that's where hip hop started from. It was just guys rapping over an R&B instrumental, like a dance break from an R&B song. Like for example, Rapper's Delight. That was just simply a dance break from Chic, Good Times. Nowadays, it's interesting to see how those elements of R&B are coming back with rappers starting to add more and more melody into their rapping style.
Like in the music, it's good to hear a lot of melody and harmony happening. And then also with the way that people rap, they rap with melody now.
Right.
Whereas the people really didn't do that. You know, like there was fluctuations of different timbres. But as far as like how people use melody now in their raps, especially with like auto-tune,
right,
like that stuff wasn't really happening back,
yeah,
back in the early 90s.
So that's something that's a unique change that you're seeing too, and because of that, it's interesting how in popular music right now you kind of see that line beginning to get blurred between kind of rapping and singing.
Rapping isn't going anywhere, but I think country, when I look back through history, I don't feel like it's ever really had its moment that has been the driving force of culture. But just the way I see things headed, especially that Lil Nas X record, Old Town Road,
gosh.
I said, to me, that's the proof right there. When you start seeing a fusion like that and it's successful, I'm thinking music is going to sound a lot like that record does. It's going to be very country driven for the culture, especially since that's being romanticized more and more now. But it still is going to feature rapping in some way.
Well, let's even go a step further. First of all, that song it broke all the records.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it broke Beatles, everything. So you've got hip-hop, rap, and country performed by an openly gay artist.
Exactly.
So that is breaking down tons of barriers.
Every single mold, every barrier.
Yes. And yet, I can't stop singing it.
I know. You still hearing it played. It's been like well over a year now.
Yeah.
So that song, it broke barriers. It really did.
I think so.
It's important to pay attention to those trends because you have to start somewhere. And sometimes finding something that's going on now that you like the way that it sounds, or maybe that you don't like how it sounds, you can take that, keep it in mind when you're writing your own music.
I mean, I guess it's a little bit different when somebody creates something new for the time and then everyone copies it.
Right.
But, you know, hip hop is built on, never made sense to me that if you rap, you can't bite anyone else's lyrics or whatever. You right. can pay respect to them, kind of like covering it, kind of, if you do it the right way.
Right.
But like all the music is just like people jacking loops off of records. Right. It's literally,
that's,
and then emulate.
Yeah. The music started off with, because like Rapper's Delight was what song?
Yeah.
Right. So it's like, that's so true.
It's, but, you know, yeah. People, you know, taking inspiration from the past and making it new. You know, I don't know. And then look, there's The Weeknd. He's got that. What's his popular song? Is it The White or whatever?
Can't Feel My Face.
No, is the popular one, the Blinded by the Light or whatever.
Blinding Lights.
Yeah, because he just jacked that Rod Stewart song and then that other song. He like combined the two songs together and just made that, but it's the same song.
Okay. What do you think the future of music will sound like?
What do I think the future of music will sound like? That is a very interesting question. And, you know, depending how far in the future we go. But one thing that I study and I've realized is that music is based off of trends.
Right.
And what's old again is new again, you know? And it's interesting how in the 70s, the drums were really dry, and then people got so sick of the drums in the 70s being so dry and dead. The 80s came around, and then it got to be so over-processed, and every hit was an explosion with reverb.
Right.
And then people got tired, and all the vocals had delay and reverb on them. And then we got to the, you know, 90s, where Nirvana came around, and it was like, okay, let's get rid of all that over processing and let's get back to room mics, but not dry drums, but not over processed drums. Right. And then, you know, we got to the 2000s where they kind of blended the 80s and the 90s together. So and then the 2000s came around, like with blending those together with the 2000s, where we had Daughtry and Nickelback, and right. then the dance tracks got to be like processed again. So I don't know, you know, my thought is, I think we're just going to regurgitate these trends over and over again, right. but put a new spin on
them. So like it's cyclical in a way.
I feel it's very cyclical, but as computer processing gets better and the toys get easier to use,
right.
you'll probably see us go in a direction where we're probably going to overprocess things again with too much many effects. And then someone's going to have a breakout album where there's going to be no effects. Like right now we've got Billie Eilish and it's layers right. upon layers. And I think it sounds great and it's done tastefully, but then there's going to be somebody else who's going to be right. bare bones. And then that's going to lead a trend that way. So I think we're just going to be very that's cyclical, you know, and with, but every cyclical time is going to have a little bit of a, it's going to have its own right, stamp it's on it.
Yeah. Yeah. I got to give you a start. Cause kind of what I was thinking of, I definitely think, because my perspective was that rapping, like as a technique, I don't think that's going anywhere. Because like, kind of like the example for me is like the electric guitar. When they started making guitars electric, that wasn't just a fad. They still are using that now. So I feel like that's gonna stay the same. But I just feel like the hip hop culture is what's gonna change. I just feel like right now, we might see a shift in that. I think we're going to hear rapping, but we're going to hear more rap over a lot more different types of sounding things, which I think would be interesting.
Yeah, that's what I would think too, now that I'm thinking about it. Like, it's going to depend on technology, and there's going to just be more like subgenres being created of music, like more fusion
right.
in different genres with rap, if I had to guess.
That's a good point, yeah.
But I mean, as far as like the sound of it, yeah, I don't know. It's like certain aspects will probably stay, remain the same, like because right. people are still using 808 drums, like they're still,
oh, yeah, that's a good,
you
yeah.
know, they were using them in the beginning and they're still using them heavy now.
Right.
So, yeah, I just think that there's going to be more subgenres, so there'll be more fusion of different sounding rap. And I think people will hear more of the subgenres right. because of technology.
Guys, so you might wonder the relevance of a question like that. What's the future of music look like? Why is that important to songwriting? Well, in addition to just for me, it's something that I like to think about and think is fascinating. It also is very important to consider that, you know, and kind of what I learned from discussing that with Anthony and Shane is some things I didn't think about, along with kind of I shared with them some of my thoughts on it. And kind of like Anthony said, you hear how it does go back and forth with the actual style of it, how it goes from being way over processed to being more simple and stripped down. And you can hear that a lot in pop music, because right now, like he mentioned, like Billie Eilish, also stuff like Travis Scott, probably a bunch of others, you know, like Justin Bieber's music, Drake, a lot of other stuff you hear. It really does have a lot of over-the-top special effects put into it, and a lot of extra processing to the vocals and to all the instruments. Like he said, it's interesting how when you listen to all the eras of music, that's pretty true. It gets to a point where it's people get tired of that because it becomes cliche and overdone. So then somebody takes all that away. And then kind of with the styles and the culture of music, I was discussing with Shane, that is interesting too. You know, just seeing the fusions that we're already seeing. How we're seeing, you know, rappers being featured on all different types of genres of music. Other genres of music using rap sounds and rapping over their stuff. So I think that all that's so interesting. And kind of like I said with my comment of rap, it's starting slowly, very slowly, but it's getting there to become a legitimate technique for vocals. Like we're not to the point where people are teaching you how to rap in schools yet. It still isn't respected to that point, but it'll get there in my opinion, because there really is a lot of skill that's evolved in rapping, which we're going to get to in the part two of this once we eventually get there. So yeah, but yeah, the relevance of that question though, when it comes to our songwriting and what we're doing, you should always be kind of looking for that what's next, always looking for the future, always kind of thinking about the different influences of what you're listening to and what's happening around you. So I think this is a very important question to ask yourself for your own writing. What do you think in 10 years people will think about of your song?
Now, something else that's important is making your music memorable. There's so many songs that we consider to be timeless. What are some of the things about those songs that make them timeless? Well, sometimes you could just simply catch lightning in a bottle, but a lot of times what makes songs timeless, it does have to do with the writing of it and how it was made. Something that I like personally is something that I kind of notice about the songs that are timeless to me. Usually when it was written, it meant something personal to the artist, and it was something relatable to anyone at any time.
Brand Nubian, those guys to do that, they had their own sound. You think like that stuff is like still relevant today, in your opinion? Like,
yeah,
how much has changed? Yeah,
I think the same thing's still going on. It's like, it's for, you know, because I'm a little older, so it's like the only difference now is we're just seeing it. This stuff's been going on, man. Like, I remember Rodney King, you know what I'm saying? Very vividly, and like how that time was. And I was listening to Brand Nubian at that time, and all the stuff they were talking about then is still relevant today for young black people and people of color. It's timeless. It's like, I have Brand Nubian records right over there. I play them still to this day. I love them.
Yeah. That's what I think is what's crazy too. It's like, that's what really makes it timeless. When you talk about the human experience, I think that's so timeless. Like, just to talk about what you're going through, like what you feel.
Yeah.
Even if stuff changes, There's a saying, as you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Yep.
So it's like true. I feel like that's a good point too, like just how timeless that was, because they were talking about what they were going through and it still applies now. Mm-hmm. That's what made it so deep.
Anytime that the message of music has some sort of a lasting effect or leaves some sort of a lasting impression on its listener, that's something that it will stick with you for years to come. And even new generations of people listening to that same song will be able to relate to it. A lot of those songs I was discussing with Shane, they were talking about experiences, what was happening, how it made people feel. And oftentimes, history truly does repeat itself. It's interesting. More things change, the more they stay the same. So that's the reason why, you know, a lot of times when you talk about social issues, you talk about personal issues, you talk about crisis, you talk about joy, those are all things that people will always be able to relate to. On the flip side, songs, they do not always have to be so serious and so meaningful, because they can still be enjoyable in different ways.
This is interesting. I had a couple people in the Bay Area. This is the early 2000s. They're singing about their life. They're singing about getting shot at. And they were singing about, you know, drugs and stuff like that. And they're like, how come we can't get signed? Yo, Anthony, why can't we get signed? And I said, well, I'm going to go back to trends. 2011 happened, or 9/11 happened in 2000, 2001, right? People are looking at the East Coast. They're singing about girls. They're singing about in the club.
Right.
You know, they're not singing about Glocks anymore. They're not singing about getting shot. I said, you have to put a beat in your music that's going to make people move.
Right.
They didn't like that answer, but they understood that.
So to Anthony's point, it's so important that we remember that there's not one way that people can enjoy their music. There's not just one way that people can get something out of what they're listening to. All the kids nowadays with the music that they like, the TikTok dances, the memes that come from them and things, that's their way of enjoying it, and there's nothing wrong with that.
There might be 300-400 different schools that I've been to, maybe even more. And what I've noticed is like the kids would be learning, would doing dances from Fortnite and stuff like that. Right. And even though that I'm teaching like history and breaking and like the tradition of hip hop that way, I just realized that like at the end of the day, it's all about fun.
Right.
Like I'm there to have fun with these kids. So it's like, if that's how they dance and interact and like that's how they have fun, then it's right. Great. So I just kind of put like everything else aside and just leave it to just having fun since it's right. Dance. So
that's true.
Yeah, so that way through TikTok and it brings them joy and they like it, like it's dope.
Right.
People have the right that they can enjoy music in whatever way that they want. If you're looking for something that you could get a deeper meaning out of, something that you can cry to, something that you could write an 8-page dissertation on possible different meanings of it, and come up with alternate storylines and craft these crazy universes like you can with, you know, so certain artists. That's cool. But it's also cool if it's a song that just makes you want to dance and move your feet. So there's plenty of different ways that you can enjoy your music.
So I've learned, for one thing, future of music and considering how music will sound in 10 years from now is so important, because it can really help us to shape what our ideas are. We should always be trying to find something new. The second thing I learned, there's more than one way that you can enjoy your music, so leave the kids alone. So I will see you guys for the next video in the series. We're gonna discuss making your music authentic, and then we're gonna discuss what are some things that are definitely the don'ts for what to do in making your music, and then some things recommended to listen to.